Well, the question is always before us is, how do we affect change? We may understand what's wrong in our system. We may want to try to wake up other people. Maybe we have woken up some other people. But how can we affect a broader change? Well, one of the ways you can do that is to run for office. Maybe. We're going to talk to someone who tried running for office, and I've had that experience as well. So we're going to talk about our experiences as independent and third-party candidates. And joining us today is David Seaman. He's a 27-year-old who ran for Congress in Florida's 20th Congressional District. He had a ground-up grassroots campaign and then withdrew from the race. And so we're going to talk to him as to what he learned in his experience. Welcome, David.
Hi, David. Thanks for having me on.
Thank you for joining us, and thank you for getting involved and caring enough to run for office. But tell us what your experience was, why you withdrew from the race, what your takeaway from the whole political experience was.
Sure. I actually didn't know that you would run also, so that'd be an interesting conversation.
Mm-hmm.
But what basically happened is I was working in various capacities as a reporter and independent journalist covering some of the more disturbing police state stories in this country, warrantless surveillance, roadside checkpoints where they're basically asked to show their papers in clear violation of the Constitution, and of course the NDAA. I was one of the first to really cover that in depth, the indefinite detention provisions, Section 1021. And so I was putting out these articles and videos, and some of them were getting a lot of traffic, but I felt like it was not actually making a difference. You know, I would write something, and then a publication would pick it up, and 50,000 people would read it. And then the next day, you feel like nothing has actually changed. You know, people read about it, they're aware that these things are happening, and they just go, oh, this doesn't really affect me, even though it truly does. And so I decided, in retrospect, mistakenly, and I think a little naively, that running for office and building this, you know, grassroots internet-based campaign would allow me to have a chance of getting into Congress, and that if you're in Congress, even though you're a freshman, you would have the ability to propose legislation to roll some of this stuff back to demand greater accountability. But what I quickly saw is that a number of forces are really set up to act as barriers to entry if you try to get into politics. And if you don't have the backing of one of the two parties, it's basically like a political cartel. If you're not a Republican or Democrat, you stand almost no chance. And if you speak out against things like drone strikes and NSA spying, then your slim chances go down to almost nothing.
Oh, absolutely. It's a very much a closed country club operation. The last time we had a viable third party candidate rise up was Abraham Lincoln, just before the Civil War, and the Republicans made sure that would never happen again. My experience is running as a third-party candidate, because you went the full route of trying to get on the ballot by yourself. That's one of the things that a third party can help you with, is to have the resources to get on the ballot, because that's, in and of itself, just getting on the ballot is such a rigged part of the process. Tell us what you had to do as an independent.
Well, as an independent, I actually withdrew back in January, so I didn't get very far in my my efforts at all. Mm. The idea was to raise money and awareness both in my district and online. And so there was a lot of online interest, but it didn't convert at all into interest within the district. You know, online people were really excited about the campaign and were spreading the word about me on, you know, various limited government websites. But then when I would actually meet with people in my district, the potential constituents, one of the first things they would ask is, are you a Democrat or Republican? And when I'd say I'm neither, I'm an independent, the reactions were not all that positive. I actually was speaking to one couple, and when I said that, the guy crossed his arms and said, well, I don't like that.
Mm-hmm,
and
mm-hmm.
It's like, what is this, King of the Hill? You know, you don't like that? Why don't you like that? And that was the reaction I got a lot. And then people would ask me, what's wrong with the woman we already have? She's a great congresswoman. She's a good Democrat. And I would really challenge people and say, what does that even mean? You know, she walked away in the middle of a filmed interview when she was asked about the NDAA and Obama's secret kill list. I don't think she's a good representative. And when you would say these things, people would go, oh, he's just he's a fringe guy. He's a teabagger. They would say these things because they've been trained by the mainstream media.
That's right.
To immediately label anybody who is different from their MSNBC-style politician, anybody who's different from that, to label that person a fringe kind of person and to automatically dismiss what they have going on.
Well, you know, that kind of training goes all the way back to government schools. You know, you look at what happens every week. It's a new opponent. You know, you got our team versus school X over here. And every time it comes up, you know, those are the bad guys. And so you're always, everything they do is to steer you into this dichotomy where it's an us versus them. Whoever that them is that changes from time to time. But people are so caught up in this left-right paradigm in the Republican and Democrat Party. And I've had people, when we were running as third-party candidates, they would get very angry about the fact that there was even third parties out there. They thought that was a very harmful situation. And it's like, why would that be harmful? You know, should we go into a grocery store where we've only got two choices of dishwashing soap? I mean, people can't make up their mind when they see more than two choices. I think we're the only democracy that I know of that has only two parties, pretty much. And even if you wanted to support strictly a two-party system, the question is, should those two parties be so firmly entrenched and calcified that you never have an option of ever changing out those two parties? I mean, that's what has really brought about the corruption, is the entrenchment of those two parties.
Yeah, even in the presidential election last year, we saw everybody making this flawed argument that, you know, whatever candidate they backed, either it was either Obama or Romney, well, he's the lesser of two evils.
Yes.
First of all, I'm
yes.
voting for him. And it's like, well, you're still voting for something that's evil then. You're voting for somebody who supports imprisonment without trial of American citizens mm-hmm. and supports killing people without proper due process, killing people using drones.
And if you notice on the liberty issues, there was not any difference whatsoever between the Republican candidate and between the Democrat candidate, because the military-industrial complex, the police-state-industrial complex, is going to make sure that their financial interests, which is eternal war and a surveillance state against the American people, they're going to make sure that those financial interests are taken care of. And so you find that even in the case of Ron Paul, for example. Now, Ron Paul ran back in 1988. He was one of the first supporters back in the late 70s, I think 76, when Reagan first ran against Ford. Ron Paul was his first and earliest supporter, and he was a very ardent supporter of Ronald Reagan. But when Ronald Reagan got in 1980, what Ron Paul saw was that Ronald Reagan was not standing up for individual liberty. He was throwing the Second Amendment under the bus. He was inflating away the currency, running up a huge deficit, getting us involved in all kinds of military war, running the drug war rampant. And so what he did was he wrote a letter of resignation in 1986, somewhat like your letter when you resigned and dropped out of the race, but more detailed about his criticisms of Reagan and how it had gone off the rail from what he had promised. And then he ran in 1988 as a Libertarian Party candidate. And I remember there was a lot of hope for Ron Paul. It was the first time we'd had a seated someone who was actually in Congress who was running as head of the party. And so he was an experienced politician, very articulate, as people have seen, and we had high expectations for it, but it basically went nowhere because the partners of the government and the media made sure that was not covered. And then look at what happened when he ran in 2012 and also in 2008. He created a groundswell of support, but look at how he was dumped in the corrupt political process within the party as well as the media.
The pundits destroyed him. It's amazing mm-hmm. how you can listen to a speech and it's quite impressive. And then, you know, in the days and weeks after that speech, pundits on the three main networks pick it apart. And instead of telling you what the person actually said, they go, oh, his foreign policy is crazy. We kept hearing that, is that his foreign policy is crazy. It's not realistic. And then you sit down and think about it and you're like, well, what's crazy about requesting congressional approval before going to war and committing American forces to some place overseas? You know, that's
yeah.
actually the most sane argument there is.
Actually following the Constitution, right?
What's that?
Actually following the Constitution.
Yeah,
that's crazy.
The laws that we are founded upon, and these pundits on TV made him out to seem like a crazy person, when I think it's crazy that the two parties, when they have these bitter debates over the budget, you know, they're talking about $2.3 trillion versus $2.7 trillion, or whatever that amount is. It's a difference of only a couple hundred billion dollars. And they're not representing the people out there who are like, why do we need to be spending trillions of dollars on surveillance programs and wars of occupation overseas, you
mm-hmm.
know?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And look at the way he was treated in the debates. If you remember, when he first ran in 2008 in the Republican Party, he was excluded from a lot of the debates. And I don't believe they excluded him from any of them in 2012. But look at what they did to Gary Johnson. Here was somebody who was a two-term governor. And he only got in one or two, maybe, of the Republican debates. And they had people who had never been elected to anything, like Herman Cain. And they had him in the debates, in all the debates. And yet, someone who had been elected And he ran as a Republican candidate in a heavily Democratic state and won re-election by an even larger margin than he had won the first time. So you've got somebody there who was not part of the insider political club. Of course, remember that even though Herman Cain had never won anything as far as an election goes, he was part of the insiders. He was part of the Federal Reserve. So, of course, they had him in all the debates, but not Gary Johnson because he was an honest outsider. And that's what we see. First of all, they play games with who's allowed on the ballot. And then once you jump through all of their hoops, and they have excessive hoops that Republican and Democrat candidates don't have to jump through, once you get on the ballot, they exclude you from the debates. And we see that even within the party, qualified candidates are excluded from debates. And so you don't really have, it's very difficult for you to get your message out there, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Gary Johnson, we saw the media kept saying that he was inexperienced. And it's like, how is a guy who's been governor of New Mexico and has summited Mount Everest and has launched his own successful, profitable tech companies, how is he inexperienced? You know?
A successful businessman, and as a politician, he exercised the veto more than all the other candidates combined. So he was effective as a governor as well and well-liked. It's very, very strange when you look at the political process. So what is your take on this moving forward? I don't want to discourage anybody from doing any kind of resistance. And I think there's value for running for political office. But what do you think?
Yes, I think other people can, succeed where I failed. For one thing, I happen to be living in one of the most difficult, loyal blue districts in the country. So I had an uphill battle from day one. I definitely don't want to discourage other people from doing what I did and maybe taking it a bit further than I was able to. But for me personally, I found that the way I can make the most difference is by acting as a force of reason within the media. So whenever I do a show like yours or a radio show or a TV show, I try to just tell people what's going on and do it without any kind of agenda because I don't care. I don't care about making Democrats look good or making Republicans look good. Right. I think both of these parties are filled with freaks at this point. Mm-hmm. The amount of money they're wasting on spying on our own people. That whole NSA program that came out today in The Guardian is loosely based off of what we did to Iraqi insurgents when we were spying on their text messages and phone calls. Right. So you now have a situation where the government considers your own rights to be at the same level of protection as an Iraqi insurgent. That's mm-hmm. pretty scary and disgusting. And for me personally, the way I can make the most difference is by improving media. I'm launching a morning show next month in Los Angeles because you see how bad morning TV has become. It's become a place where if you even mention Edward Snowden, they freeze up and either mock it or they immediately say he's a traitor. You know, he shouldn't have released that information. And unfortunately, you and I see through that, but there are millions of people who really don't because they haven't been exposed to alternative media yet and they just take that stuff at face value. So I'm really convinced that we need to change the media so we can have a more honest discussion in this country. And then that'll make it easier for third party candidates like yourself and for independents like me to actually get somewhere.
That's right. I think we're at the point where we have to get people to recognize that the emperor has no clothes. And one of the things we can do is tell people about it. But, you know, I think that when Ron Paul ran, both as a third party candidate and both of the times that he ran within the Republican Party, I think that was a real seminal moment for people who really had the scales removed from their eyes. They had a very optimistic view of America as being this land of law, as land of liberty. They thought there were rules that if you played by the rules, you're going to get recognized. And they saw some really dirty political tricks, a lot of dishonesty. I mean, look at even keeping him out of a speaking position at the Republican Party by having this fake voice vote that they had already pre-scripted on the teleprompter, and somebody caught it and put the scripting of the voice vote up. And so, I mean, it was just so incredibly rigged in the various states. I think that had a lot of value, however. It got people to understand that the emperor has no clothes. We have a lot of mind control that goes on through the media and through the school systems, and it trains people to believe that we have this honest, freedom-oriented government, and they need to have those scales taken off. And we can tell them directly, but a lot of times they have to experience it directly. So I think it's a very important thing for people to get involved in the electoral process, just so people can see the corruption and experience it firsthand. That's going to get them to question why a government like that should be reading every bit of electronic mail that we have, why they should have the ability to kick down our doors at will and come in guns blaring in a no-knock raid. That's the kind of government that we have, and people see how that government reacts once they get involved in the political system.
Yes, definitely. And to go back to the difference that media makes for a second, I've had people, friends of mine who are, you know, kind of big government Democrats who thought that they were supportive of Obama. And after me sending them, you know, so many YouTube videos of clips that we've all seen of, you know, roadside checkpoints where people are forced to get out of their cars and they're yelled at and groped and, you know, they have their bras searched for, you know, paraphernalia and drugs. And then some of these TSA checkpoints where they now have canine units, and they force you to walk through something that's basically a microwave oven. When people watch these videos, regardless of their political preferences, the reaction is visceral. You know, there's a disgust that wells up, disgust and a realization that something needs to change. And so that's why I think that just getting the information out there is so important, because we can't become better voters until we realize that this stuff really is happening. You know, it's one thing to watch MSNBC and think that everything is okay, but then when you just go out into the world, like just for me to walk to the closest Starbucks, I'll pass by about 25 surveillance cameras at street intersections. So you realize that something is really wrong there. At the very least, it's a huge waste of our resources, and we only have so much resources as a society. But, you know, in a more sinister direction, it's a real forfeiture of our rights that has occurred over the past decade, and that seems to be intensifying over the past couple of years.
Oh, yeah, it's accelerating very quickly. Now, you've decided, as I think Ron Paul has, I think Ron Paul is going to have even more impact as he starts to do a news organization, and especially this curriculum that he's got, because that's really where you get people's minds, is as early a possible age as possible, forming a worldview, giving them a perspective of how things work, and trying to do that as early as possible. So I think he's going to have a lot of impact there. But now your program is going to be in L.A., a morning show, is what you're saying? And where is that going to run? Is that going to be on public access, or is it going to be a network? Or?
Good question. We're looking at a couple of different options in terms of getting it on TV. But it's going to come out on iTunes and YouTube every weekday. And there's going to be a high-definition format that people can download. And the production quality is really important to us. We want it to look just like Today Show or CBS's early morning show. But instead of only talking about you know, Trayvon and these other divisive issues, we want to use that time to really go in depth into things like, why is the government spending nearly $2 billion for a data center in Utah to log our communications? You know, why is the TSA continue to expand? What is the actual payoff here? Has this stopped a single terrorist attack? So these are the things that we want to spend time talking about on the morning show. And yeah, it's going to be distributed in as many ways as possible, and it's going to be free for people to access. You won't need a cable subscription.
Okay, great. Well, if people want to find out more about that and find out how they can help support you, they can go to davidseaman.net. Is that correct? And you've got an Indiegogo project that's going on now to get funding?
Yeah, thank you so much, David, for plugging that. If people go to my website, to davidseaman.net, there's a video right at the top right now where I talk about the morning show and our goals, and there's also a link somewhere on there. So people can see where we're at funding-wise. We're 78% fully funded, funded by listeners and people who read my articles. And it's cool that we're being funded by people who actually want this news instead of being funded by, you know, like News Corporation or something like that. So we're funded by the viewers, 78% there. And I'm hoping that within the next few days we'll be fully funded. So if people want to check that out, the video's over there.
Great, great. Well, thank you, David, for your activism. Thank you for getting involved. And thank you for continuing to plug away at it. Even when one avenue doesn't work, we just turn around and we try something else. But we can't give up on liberty. It's just too important. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you. It's a marathon, not a sprint. I really believe that at this point.
That's right. Thank you.
Thanks.
Bye-bye. Well, as David said, it's very important that people wake up. How are they going to wake up? What form of activism are you going to take? Well, at this point, I wouldn't discourage anybody from getting involved in the political process, as I said, but I think that there's a lot of groundwork that still needs to be done to wake people up. One of the ways you can do that is with documentaries. One of the best ways you can do that, and our documentary, State of Mind, it's actually not our documentary, but we're selling it here exclusively at InfoWars, started shipping yesterday. And tomorrow night, we are going to have a premiere on Prison Planet TV. And it's going to be a full roundtable discussion by the filmmaker's crew. They're going to give commentary as they watch this premiere, so you won't want to miss that. It's a very important way for people to understand exactly how they're being manipulated by the media, by the government, by the school system. Mind control is much larger than just the MK Ultra program or COINTELPRO. It extends to so many different aspects of our society. And they talk about the full history of that. They talk about it broadly and all these different aspects. So don't miss that tomorrow night. You can also get your copy at InfoWarsStore.com. You can use that as a very effective way to wake people up. And we ask that you also support Prison Planet TV if you're watching this broadcast on YouTube. Your subscription helps to provide our budget, our bandwidth charges. And with one subscription, you can get up to 10 friends can watch this at the same time with you. Well, that's it for tonight. We'll be back tomorrow night with the premiere of State of Mind. And that's going to start right after the news. The news will begin at 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern.
This is Antonio Beeler of the Peaceful Streets Project. I'm here to invite you to a concert featuring Jordan Page here in Austin, Texas, this Thursday, July 18th. This concert will help fund the Peaceful Streets Project annual Police Accountability Summit, which will be the culmination of a crazy year and a half. We started with my New Year's arrest for trying to take pictures of and stop two thug cops from assaulting a woman who had committed no crime. I subsequently joined with other activists here in Austin to launch a Peaceful Streets Project to bring about a cultural shift so that people would stand up for their rights while staying together to bring accountability to criminal cops. Since then, the Peaceful Streets Project has given victims of police abuse a platform to share their stories. We've hosted dozens of Know Your Rights trainings, organized over 100 cop watches, and hosted a successful police accountability summit where we gave out 100 cameras to people in need so they could film the police. We were also named the Grassroots Movement of the Year by the Austin Chronicle, and now we're going national. We currently have a dozen chapters nationwide in cities such as Dallas, Houston, New York, Manchester, New Hampshire, and Sandusky, Ohio. This Thursday, July 18th, Liberty rocker Jordan Page will be coming to Austin, Texas to perform at a private benefit concert to help raise funds for our second annual Police Accountability Summit that will be held on August 17th. The money we raise is necessary to offset the cost of the venue, as well as the cost associated with our featured guests, which include Radley Balco, author of Rise of the Warrior Cop, Bobby Seale, co-founder of the Black Panthers, Carlos Miller, creator of PhotographyIsNotACrime.com, Pete Ayer of coplock.org, and musicians B. Dolan and Tatiana Moroz. There are three ways you can help us make this benefit concert and summit a success. First, please share this video with friends via email, Facebook, and Twitter. Second, come to the benefit concert this Thursday in Austin. Go to peacefulstreets.com/JordanPage to prepay. And third, come to and or donate to the second annual Police Accountability Summit. Go to peacefulstreets.com/donate for more information. Together, we can bring down the police state.
Now you can watch the InfoWars nightly news streaming live as it happens for free.
Check it out at InfoWars.com/show.
Are we choosing our own paths, our own destiny? Or has it been pre-selected for us?
C.S. Lewis said, when training beats education, civilization dies.
We need to always be cognizant of, as a free society, that information can be used as a weapon.
Barrier to discovery is not ignorance. It's the illusion of knowledge.
We are seen as nothing but biological androids.
To gain control of education in America, not for a philanthropic purpose, but to change the thinking of the American people.
From the time we're very young, we're taught to, you know, worship authority, basically, because that's our key to survival as young children.
Discover the history, the present, and the future of mind control. From compulsory state education to the Hollywood media brainwashing machine, we are kept in perpetual bondage to the ideas that shape our actions.
In the CIA, scientists could actually film people who had been surreptitiously dosed with LSD.
There's a brain entrainment process that takes place.
That gives the government free rein to create whatever story or narrative it wants to create.
Whatever the public face of something is, whatever they're talking about publicly, there's something else over here they're probably not looking at.
How to engineer the opinion of the American people so that they would fully endorse, not only endorse, but demand a war.
When you watch mainline establishment television, you are putting yourself in front of the barrel of a gun.
Discover the history, the present, and the future of mind control, psychological warfare, brainwashing. Are we controlled and manipulated? You bet.
That's mind control par excellence.
Find out how deep the rabbit hole really goes with this new groundbreaking documentary film, State of Mind. Available exclusively at InfoWars.com.
Because there's a war on for your mind. That has been our motto here at InfoWars for my 18 years of battle against the globalist. And now we see the open announcements of global, private, corporate tyranny over our governments. That's what the New World Order is an unaccountable, private combine of organized crime engaged in corporate takeovers of nation states and the conscious attempt to abolish basic rights and fundamental liberties. InfoWars.com is not just leading the charge against this here in the U.S. or North America. We are leading the charge worldwide. And that's because our listeners, our viewers, our supporters, fellow freedom lovers like you across the planet resonate with our message of liberty and telling it like it is. And that's why for the last 2 years especially, I have thrown everything I've got, my time, my energy, our backup capital, everything into really trying to awaken the sleeping giant that is humanity. And that's why the July issue that just came in a few days ago is so important. We've already sold about half the stock we have of it at cost in groups of 10 up to 100 in bulk. It covers the entire NSA spy grid, how it ties in worldwide, how it's not about stopping terrorists, but about suppressing and dominating and controlling the free press and political opposition. And in this magazine, we don't just have three free bumper stickers like I did a few months ago. We have 10 bumper stickers, four full-size ones with amazing messages guaranteed to get people thinking like America has been occupied by globalist forces. InfoWars.com. Listen to Alex Jones at InfoWars.com. InfoWars.com. Forbidden information. Listen to Alex Jones. InfoWars.com. And then on top of it, six medium-sized bumper stickers with the message as well. These are key to post in legal and lawful areas on your book bag, your computer, your car, or to give friends and family. I have printed 500,000 of these bumper stickers. Only half of this month's run of magazines has them. So when you purchase them in bulk or you're a 12-month subscriber, you will get the special issue. And I can't afford to do this every month, so it's going to be quite a while until we do this again. Please take advantage of this. Buy them in bulk and give them to your friends and family and encourage them to get these bumper stickers out, because with 500,000 stickers, we can reach tens of millions of people with the message of truth. They want to collectivize us. They want to bankrupt us. They want to drive us into their arms to control us. They want to dumb us down. But the sleeping giant that is free humanity is awakening. So I want to thank you all for your support. I want to encourage everybody to go to InfoWarsStore.com and to get a 12-month subscription or to give a gift subscription. Imagine 12 of these coming to your friends or family's door to wake them up. Or to give a gift subscription to the local police department or your local congressman or woman. This is how we're going to affect change, voting with our dollars and voting with our time. Again, visit InfoWarsStore.com today to subscribe, to get the magazine in bulk, or to give a gift subscription, or to give yourself a subscription to wake up friends and family. I am all in. I am committed 110% to not mince words and to not back off and to boldly confront the globalist. So I want to thank all of you that have supported us in the past, and I want to encourage all of you out there who may be on the fence, that know this information is true, but have been scared to take action. You had better be scared of not taking action and letting this monstrous system come to fruition. Now is the time to commit. Now is the time to say which side of history you're on. Now is the time to stand against the globalist and the New World Order. And regardless of whether you get this July issue, this July 4th Resistance to Tyrants issue, spread the word about liberty, resist corruption in your area. Millions of us doing little things can move mountains together. I'm Alex Jones, signing off for InfoWars.com and the InfoWars team.